A year ago, over here, right here, Ivan Krastev, Daniel's colleague, was talking about the fact that the crisis we've been observing may be described as a crisis of interdependency, meaning the world is becoming more and more global. But this globalization turns out to be negative. The response towards globalization is negative. How can you go through this crisis? You have to find a way to deal with these negative responses. There were certain positive and negative expectations. And similar ideas like open trade, open frontiers, free movement of capital, it may be to our advantage, but it also may be considered as something fearful. So mess of negative expectations and fears during the last year have been growing up. This crisis of refugees shows actually the dilemma between fears and values. And it may be described as temptation. Maybe it is a test because you require some internal work. It's not actual threats, but it's rather fears. There are many more fears than real threats. And politicians work with these fears. And we clearly see two logics. Logics of fear and logics of values. The first was eloquently mentioned by Hungarian Prime Minister Viktor Orban. I will quote. He was saying that mass migration is like a slow stream which kills the banks. Its actual reason is to occupy the territory, and this territory is occupied by migrants, and that means that we lose these territories. This kind of logic appeals to use of force in her openness and transborder solidarity. It sees the threat to one's sovereignty, and sovereignty is considered to be better than human rights. Political development, political response to this kind of logic is the process of strengthening of the right parties, strengthening of nationalism, and powerful wave of populism. Yes, it's all been growing during the last year. The logic of ideals is based on historic memory, collective memory of European countries about refugees, about the refugees crisis during the Second World War. There are publications to the effect that the number of migrants increased, number of modern immigrants increased, the figure of immigrants during the World War II. So we look back at that situation. Ivan Krastev here was saying a year ago that the European community was set by nations who lost the war. And the basis for this solidarity is a general experience of defeat. And What was lost was real human values underlying this kind of policy. In August 2015, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of France criticized the Hungarian wall at the border with Serbia. He said that we remember when we were refugees in Europe, and this wall contradicts to European values. What about European identity in general? This crisis is a fear of something alien, and we have to recall the foundation for these values related to exception of something foreign or alien. The foundation of the European identity is interaction with new elements, new nations, new mentalities which come to Europe. And Europe for many years worked it over, managed to work it over, to process. So the experience of religious wars was mentioned by Lev Schlossberg, and he said that values were developed in a crisis time. You should be tolerant to something new, to something alien. And this was the result of confessional wars. I mean, this value Europe managed to move to the exception of each other, to reception of each other. Paradoxically enough, to retain your identity, you have to, in a certain way, to say no to your identity, to get it back at the new level. Well, there is a gospel fable about a grain. Well, you drop grains on the ground, if at least one survives, it will bring good fruits. There are many other examples from culture and philosophy that you have to accept something alien, and this is a forming point of the European identity. We may mention Emmanuel Levinas, who developed the philosophy of something alien, of something foreign. To retain your entity, you should know how to say no to this entity, to receive it at the new level. So if we try to retain our entity with all our strengths, we may become isolated, and this entity may be lost. So, about a few words about the political development of the logic of fear. It's more complicated when we speak about how values are formed. If we consider this opposition between fear and values, the reasonable policy looks for ways to integrate fears without ignoring them. Brexit is a good example. It says that if you ignore emotions and accumulated fears, you may certainly face the results of referendum, which was unexpected for many. Well, I'm nearing completion of my presentation. What happens in the civil society, or with the civil society in Russia, in Europe? This is some sort of a sleeping value, meaning the acceptance of something foreign. But now this is being has been tested. The same is true about democratic values in Russia. What we got by way of advance, and it looked to us as something obvious, something that was taken for granted. But now we see that you have the rights which you can, which you are ready to stand for. You may develop a policy at the new level, a policy of interaction with something new, an integration of the new and the work with fears. That's the foundation of a new universal policy, the policy of new universalism. We here use the hospitality, enjoy the hospitality of the Bosch Foundation, and it would be nice to remember here Jeronim Bosch. This is just a picture because you are all tired, and we were asked to give you jokes and show some pictures. So that's the picture. This year is the year of 500 years of the death of Bosch. Several exhibitions were organized to this effect. In the history of arts, Bosch remained as an artist who showed the awful, the horrible side of reality. Middle Ages knew only too well the horrible and the fearful. Bosch was not the one who discovered it, but he was one of the first painters of Northern Renaissance. At the new level, or on the new level, he managed to show something new. The accumulation of the awful was accumulated, was already there in Europe, and he put all this on the canvas, showing all fears, something fearful and something bright, and all this was in one picture. The same was made by Dante Alighieri, who used Inferno and combined it with a perfect cosmos, space. So it's the fight between fears and values. Values may lose, it's pretty serious. But if they win, we shall probably be able to deal with new level of generalization, new picture, new cosmos. Hopefully, Europe is strong enough to respond to the challenges by providing new example of universalism, which we've been discussing here. I have a question to you. Europe goes through migration issue not for the first time, but now it's on the other side of the barricades. In the period of the Second World War, countries of the Middle East, like Syria and Lebanon, they received hundreds and thousands of Europeans refugees, and they gave them a refuge. You mentioned the biblical story of the grain. And this says that this is our moral obligation to receive a foreigner, give him food, a roof over his head. So the countries which are against distribution of humanitarian migrants, do they violate this biblical imperative of hospitality? Yeah, well, that's what it's about. It's the issue of a degree, to what we are ready to exercise these values when well, this thing touches us directly, of course we have to remember the examples of dealing with refugees in time of the Second World War. But when it happens now, we may feel that we are engulfed by something alien and foreign. I cannot provide you with a ready answer. Fear may be absolutely grounded, substantiated. A possible recipe is if these values are not an abstraction, but something vital and tested by the time. So you should probably, on the basis of such values, to try to do away with your fears.
I'll address my question to Daniel. Mikhail was saying that anti-Europe is rising based on anti-European attitudes stretching from Vladivostok to Lisbon, and Brexit shows it only too well, showing us that successful countries no longer see any common Europe project to be so attractive. Please tell us if it is really the case, and if so, what's the reason for that, and why this anti-Europe from Vladivostok to Lisbon may turn into a reality.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I really appreciate this opportunity to speak in front of you. Well, all these questions are very relevant, and I'm not sure whether I'll be able to give an intelligent answer to them, but I'll try anyhow. I agree with both of the speakers before me that we should think of integrated Europe as an universalistic project. So it's a project based on values. It pretends to be universal, but it is very important to stress that it is based on specific values. And these are the values of, let's say, solidarity and compassion. Because the main idea of United Europe is that whenever you have a common problem, you should try to resolve it through cooperation, through sharing of the burdens, through even power sharing. And this is actually the essence of this drive to create supranational institutions, to share sovereignty, and to somehow share even powers with others who are affected by your decision. So exactly this model at the moment is facing several crises. And some of them look quite dramatic. I don't think we should panic, but even listing them, the situation doesn't look very good. So we have the, of course, the migration crisis, which is the topic of this panel. But there was also the euro crisis, which raises exactly the same questions. Are the countries in the eurozone better off together, providing cooperative, collective answers to the difficulties they face, or are they better off on their own? And there is some sort of disagreement, although with the eurozone crisis, at least we did have some temporary but hopeful solution as regards to the Greece situation. The refugee and migration crisis also looks bad, although I agree with a speaker in the morning who said that actually, compared to the resources with which Europe has at its disposal, this crisis doesn't look that dramatic. It's a matter of coordination and logistic kind of operations. So when you have a union of 500 million people with a budget of $20 trillion or something like that, so you can't be really shocked by an influx of refugees of 1 million or a bit more over a few years. Yes, it creates complications, but if there is will, these complications should be relatively easy to solve. I'll give you an example. Take, for instance, Poland or Hungary. These are relatively rich countries by comparative world standards. So for such countries to discuss whether to have quotas of 1,000 or a few thousand people, refugees, accommodated on their territory, is really not a problem of resources. It's absurd to discuss this in these terms. Apparently, their governments, Orban was mentioned, we can put there Kaczynski and some others, apparently they want to make this an issue of principle. So it's not that they cannot afford or they'll be stressed dramatically by such quotas, but they want to say, look, we are standing behind a different principle. And here I slightly disagree with Misha, who said that we should think of Orban and Kaczynski and others as particularists. Well, it may be, so it's a methodological choice. But the point is that they don't say, look, we have these special Polish or Hungarian values, please leave us alone and do whatever you like. On the contrary, they say, do as we do. We think that we are right and we offer another universalistic project to Europe, and we think that our universalistic project is better than yours. That the future of Europe actually is this future of fatherlands or motherlands that we propose, and this Europe of solidarity and compassion and so on is something of the past. So in fact, we have a clash of two types of universalistic projects, one based on solidarity and compassion, and one which is universal egoism, let's put it like that. So everyone is better off if they are solving problems as they can. So this is the battleground. And the question is, which one of these two projects is going to win the hearts of the people? And I do have some evidence of a recent study. This study is done by the Michigan State University, and this practically is the map of compassion of the world. The red is countries in which compassion is generally high, and white and pink and so on are countries in which compassion is relatively low. And as you see, generally, Europe doesn't look that bad because there is quite a lot of red around, but there are striking exceptions. In this study, 7 out of the 10 bottom countries in terms of compassion are in Eastern Europe, which is quite remarkable when you think it. The lowest is Lithuania, so I hope there are not a lot of people from Lithuania here, but anyhow, it doesn't matter. My country is also very well on this table. So you see, there are some problems also in the UK and some other countries, very low measures of compassion. And if we treat compassion as some sort of indicator of solidarity, you see that that this project that Orban and others is advocating has gained some currency. So we cannot disregard it simply as something fanciful. It's a real threat that should be addressed. And by the way, I don't think that it should be treated as a marginal European phenomenon, as something which affects practically the eastern periphery or some other peripheral countries, and the UK, which has always been in a special position. But the picture for the UK, I think, is quite telling about processes which happen practically everywhere in Europe. So this slide shows the difference between people who have voted for Brexit and people who have voted against Brexit. You can see that if you believe that multiculturalism, social liberalism, globalization, and immigration are something bad and threatening, you are very likely to vote for Brexit. And on the contrary, if you think that these are forces for good, so you vote for Leave. This is the dividing line. And you see that this dividing line goes through this line of solidarity and compassion. So if you don't feel some solidarity and compassion, if you don't believe that you have some duties towards minorities or migrants or other groups, well, you're likely to be on this line of Brexit voters, and more generally, you are likely to support the rise of national populism. So these are the processes, and they had been illustrated with the rise of Euroscepticism and so forth. I don't think that we have to treat these as happening only among different states in Europe. These processes actually affect internal politics as well. So they undermine solidarity not only between and among states, but also among groups within societies. So this is another interesting aspect which has to be kept in mind when we discussing these phenomena. But anyhow, they are here, and the question is, what should be done about them? How do we proceed from here regarding the European Union, and then more broadly? And as you can imagine, I don't have the answer. I'm just thinking aloud. But possible answers, they start from very radical positions, and some people, they draw analogies with the 1930s. And they say, look, a new dark age is coming, these authoritarians are on the rise, so we have to react. But I think that the analogy with the 1930s is not helpful, because these are not necessarily totalitarian or authoritarian movements which are doing this type of damage. So they cannot be simply banned and closed down as anti-democratic, because actually, they are not in this category. So they are not all of them fascists and so on. So if this is not the case, what else? Another possible option is because Europe indeed is a project of solidarity, but it's an incomplete project, because this solidarity affects specific areas, not all areas. And some say, well, now is the moment to push for the extension of solidarity in other areas. Let's have, let's say, a common military defense and so on and so forth. Well, this possibly is a good idea, but if now this issue is pressed at the European level, it risks to undermine the whole project, because if we are engaged in a series of complex treaty changes with referenda and ratifications, the chance of having the whole European project, in fact, exploding is very, very high. So I don't think that massive institutional change should be put on the table, which means that what is left is some muddling through option in which we try to preserve as much as possible what has been already achieved and not dismantling it. So it's an age of resisting and age of resilience of institutions, if you will, and possible gradual improvements here and there, like in the migration area. For instance, it's a good idea to have common border controls of the external borders, some sort of orderly procedures treating the migrants, functioning quota system and so on. These are all welcome developments which could be tried. And I'll end with this. What is probably most important and issue which has not been discussed a lot is, in such situations in which obviously European institutions are still not in place. We don't have all the infrastructure necessary for a solidaristic type of governance in Europe. So when you don't have all these institutions, when the institutions are underdeveloped, the whole burden actually lies with the political leadership, with the people who lead different countries, and with the political establishment in terms of mainstream parties. And when you think about it, we talk about the reform of the European Union and so on, but actually the whole debate between Merkel and Orban, let's say, takes part in the European People's Party. So it's a kind of issue which could be settled probably within party families. They should have more discussion about it, come up with a position, probably try to put pressure in these more informal, not fully institutional ways within the framework of leadership meetings and so on and so forth. So in general, when institutions are missing, we should try to, and this has been said many times, to stress on the political culture, try to build up this political culture which will support solidarity and this project of Europe is based on the value of solidarity. Okay, thanks.
Спасибо, Daniel. Даниэль, у меня есть к вам один вопрос. Скажите, действительно ли вы думаете, что это большая ошибка думать, что Европа существует только в Праге, Будапеште, Варшаве, Братиславе, тех странах, в которые освобождаются от чужих иностранцев, пришельцев, и тем самым защищают Европу любой ценой?
Yeah, I think that this is the wrong idea that some people are peddling, that Europe is some sort of a Christian community which has to be defended on these terms by isolating it from the rest of the world. So I think this is wrong-headed. It's in fact impossible idea, and I'll give you an example. Well, it's easy for Orban to advocate this idea because first, Hungary is in the middle of Europe geographically. Actually, it's surrounded by other countries. But he came to Bulgaria and tried to sell this idea to our prime minister, who and many others sympathized with some positions that Orban holds. But in Bulgaria, for instance, this is a totally unworkable idea. First, we have 10% Muslim Turkish minority. So what does it mean that Europe should be shut down for Muslims? Secondly, we're bordering state with Turkey. We do have a wall, as Misha said, but in Bulgaria, everyone understands fully well that what resolves this situation is not the wall. Because if you have 100,000 people in front of the wall, what do you do? You start shooting or water cannoning or what? So this is a kind of non-workable solution. And what has worked is the so criticized deal between the European Union and Turkey, actually, repatriation and so on. Although it has many flaws, but this sort of agreement, actually, together with some other agreements negotiated with countries like Afghanistan and so on, has realistically managed to somehow to reduce the migrant pressure on Bulgaria. So my point was that the Bulgarian government knows fully well that this might be a good rhetoric for winning votes at elections among certain groups, but these are unworkable in our context proposals. So this is this universalism of universal egoism simply doesn't work for us. So it was not welcomed in Bulgaria.
Thank you. Diana, now it's floor's yours. У меня есть к вам, окей. У меня есть к вам один вопрос. Как мы слышали, предыдущие панелисты говорили.
Melissa, they were talking about the fact that migrants turned out to be the test for many countries of Europe. So the question of attitude towards migrants is a test for politicians in these countries. What, to your mind, is the side that is responsible, and how should you build relationships, political relationships, so that interactions between aliens and locals were friendly, human, open, and for mutual favor, for mutual favor.
I think that's a very good question, and a question that is quite hard to answer, especially since Romania is one of the countries that presents a lot of negative attitudes towards migrants. But I will try to present and hopefully answer a little bit the question in my presentation. Yes. So my presentation will focus mostly on integration policies, and of course with very small focus on Romania. The general focus of the presentation, as I've said, integration policies, and somehow I try to place them in the context of rising nationalism. Just a few characteristics of European nationalism, Euroscepticism, favoring a return to the national states, because the national states have the sovereignty and, according to some, the power to deal with the current refugee crisis. The second one would be a populist discourse that plays on the fears of the population, and this brings me to the third characteristic, which is anti-migration, a very strong anti-immigration discourse in a form of maintaining the status quo, the power, and of course one of the reasons would be maintaining and preserving national identity. In terms of integration and integration policies, we have the Communication on Immigration, Integration and Employment, which states that integration is actually a two-way process, in the sense that both the migrant and the host society have mutual rights and obligation. It's not just the migrant that is trying to integrate, but rather the host society has a responsibility to help. And since we were talking about a crisis of values, solidarity, one of the core values of the immigration policy of the European Union project, is at the core of the integration process. On the one hand, states should provide solidarity, and at the same time, the community. The community should be able to interact and support the integration of migrants. I consider solidarity to be connected to human rights, because when the so-called refugee crisis began, it was a problem of people fleeing war, fleeing destruction, fleeing death, and as a country, as a member state of the European Union, as a citizen, as a European citizen, we all have the obligation to respect, promote human rights, respect the values of the European Union, and of course provide, show solidarity to those people fleeing, fleeing conflict. This is somewhat strange, the fact that in 2015, 56% of EU residents actually had negative feelings towards non-EU migration, which again raises the question of whether solidarity exists, whether the current refugee crisis or the migration crisis has tested solidarity both at national level but also at European level. This is a graphic of MIPEX integration index, which basically measures integration policies and integration in European states and also in certain states outside of the European Union. This is the total score. I won't delve too much into this. I will just say that in terms of integration policies, the greatest weaknesses are education, in the sense that educational policies are usually more structured in countries that are destination countries that receive a large inflow of migrants, and also political participation. Usually there are very, very few countries at European level that provide for political participation of migrants. Romania is not one of them. Romania does not provide any type of political participation. In terms of the Romanian integration policies, they provide for basic support for integration, usually located in larger cities. Also, the integration policies are highly dependent. The implementation, actually, of the integration policies is highly dependent on civil society, and that raises a big problem because civil society lives on European funds. When those funds end, so do the program for migrants. Since Romania, well, solidarity is not really at home towards migrants, this creates a gap for migrants and for their status in society. The Romanian National Migration Agenda does not perceive migration as an opportunity, something that can benefit both parties, the migrant and the host society, but rather it sees it as an occurrence, something that is happening and we have to deal with it. As a result, most of the policies, the national agenda, aims at alleviating the effects, not necessarily having a long-term target, but rather just coping with what is happening at the moment. And of course, this does not really lead to successful integration of migrants. This is the MIPEX index, but relating to Romania. And I've chosen just three pillars of the many that are labor market mobility, education, and access to nationality. I will tell you just very, very briefly that in terms of education, Romania received the second lowest score alongside Hungary and Turkey. We do have education laws that are great in theory. Their implementation is a bit difficult in practice, and that is usually because there is no solidarity. And when I speak about solidarity in this case, I refer to solidarity between the different actors, political actors, the different social actors, and the community. Creating an integration policy and implementing is very important to do so in the context of solidarity and the respect of human rights and of the European values. I will briefly go to conclusions, which I think are the most important. The fact that we've already seen at European level certain countries that have begun restricting access to citizenship, access to long-term residence. I conclude that the rise of nationalism has a huge potential to influence integration policies on the short term, on the medium term, but it has this influence. and as a result to disregard European values and the human rights approach. At the same time, the second conclusion that I come up the second conclusion is that integration policies should be implemented in a context of solidarity. The European Union was based on the approach, on the human rights approach, on certain values that provide for solidarity, cooperation, tolerance. All of these integration policies have to be implemented in such a context so as to function, so as to be successful. Last but not least, something for you to think about as well, the fact that migration, since the so-called refugee crisis, which I don't think to be a crisis at all, migration has been seen from a legalistic standpoint, an administrative one. How many migrants can we accommodate? How many refugees can we accommodate? Do we have the financial means to cope with all of them? Can the European Union has the right the European Union to oblige us to take more migrants than we want? And we've left aside the humanitarian approach, that which says that according to human rights conventions, to which all European member states are party, it says that a person seeking refuge has the right to find that refuge. A person fleeing conflict, fleeing death, has the right to go into another country and seek asylum, become a refugee. Now we've let these values somehow aside, and we've focused more on things relating to the power of the states, the sovereign state. So maybe this is a question to think about, whether a human rights approach, whether the human rights and human rights approach should be more important than, or are more important than, the capacity of states and the sovereign state. Thank you.
Спасибо большое. Спасибо большое паталистам. Я кратко суммирую выступление наших спикеров и напомню вам о том, что Иммануил Кант.
Then Immanuel Kant once said about the right for hospitality. He thought that it's an absolute right of every human being. And Nikolai rightly said that you have to be determined about your right on hospitality. You have to determine the responsibilities of our guests and rights of those who receive them, even under the situation when we are between fears and search for our ideals. Daniel was saying that European potential is so great that this migration crisis is not a threat to Europe, although many architects of Europe, like former Chancellor Schmidt, said that only nucleus of Europe would remain with time, because there would be crisis which we would be able to resolve, or we shall not be able to do so. Mikhail, in his presentation, was also saying that those are current challenges and they are diverse and modified, and probably we were not ready for these. He said that right, radical and populist movements, they got united despite different platforms and movements, and that's a very interesting phenomenon. Even in Germany, a popular alternative for Germany is mottoed against migrants. There are 16 lands in Germany. They have their own mottos. In one land, important thing is cancellation of road taxes, and populists and radicals, they are so mobile and flexible now, and the liberals and other political parties were not ready for it. They didn't expect this kind of flexibility from these people. And Diana calls for the following. In our modern society, migrants are not a danger. They do not constitute a danger. This is a two-way process of communication and interaction between the receiving society and people who are received. And that's where I would like to make a stop. And now, questions, Q&A time. Let us take three questions in a row. And just ask whom you want to address your question to. A young man in a suit and a shirt. Not only a suit and a shirt.
I'm Filatov and I'm from Russia. I'm the alumni of the Moscow School of Political Studies. And my question is to Mikhail Minakov. Mikhail, I remember that 3 years ago in Galitsyn on the seminar, you said that what we see in Ukraine will have very serious consequences, not only for Russia and Ukraine, but for the Europe. And I was pretty skeptical to what you said, but now that I see that you was right. And today you said that the current crisis, the current war, it will have impact for two generations. Why you have such an estimate? What is and does this forum here in Berlin, in search of lost universalism, make sense nowadays, if the perspective of reconciliation is so long?
Thank you. Márton Vész from Hungary, and there has been a couple of mentions of my country and my government. A few. And I'm representing Mr. Orbán's party's youth organizations. So if I may, I'd like to reply with a few thoughts, because I think there has been a few misunderstandings. First of all, there has been a quote from the French foreign minister about our fence in our southern border. He wasn't the only one. There was another guy called Chancellor Faymann, if you ever heard of him, from Austria. And he also thought that this fence would be a bad idea. Then he built one himself and left power very soon. But I don't want to reply everything because that would take a lot of time, but there has been a kind of accusation that we are ultra-conservative and illiberal. Many of you might have heard Mr. Orbán's speech quite 2 years ago, I think, about illiberal democracies. It has a problem in a translation to English because, actually it is, because the problem is in Hungary, we have some bad experiences with a certain liberal party. And actually, that speech was about them much more than about in a theoretical or academical illiberalism. I don't think so that any of Hungarians doesn't feel themselves European, because our government and most of our people support our membership in the EU. My opinion is that we need a European Federation, and government supports, for example, a European army if it's necessary to help the people in Syria or Iraq during this conflict against ISIS, for example.
Could we come to the question?
Actually, I don't have a question because.
Then thank you so much for your remarks. We will start with the answer.
Sorry, just one thought that there has been so many misunderstandings, and it's really doesn't help to the understanding each other if we are talking about different language of different perspective. And I wanted to just make clear that some of the things has been said here was not based on understanding of Hungary in Hungarian perspective.
Thank you so much. Then we will start with the answering. Mikhail, will you start?
Я начну по-русски, да? По-русски. Восточная Европа как регион конфликта.
Region of conflicts. have a look at what happens at our neighborhood within the last 25 years, and the development of post-Soviet region is a regular loss of democratic rights and economic freedoms. We have a political consensus. In political science, Henry Hill 2 months ago published an article where he mathematically showed that we try to cut down the slow movement towards dictatorships, towards authoritarianism, but slowly but surely we degrade and move closer towards regimes of non-freedom. In our own political systems, we have been less free. There is another aspect of conflicts between the post-Soviet states. Long-term cooperation between our peoples was mostly at the level of elites or marginal groups, the poorest ones who had to migrate. Now, there has been several generations of people for whom Moscow is an unknown city. My students know all the addresses of good cafes and bars in Warsaw, Dublin, London, Milan, but they have no idea about Moscow. Between Kyiv and Moscow, Minsk and Chisinau, there is a great gap which has been growing for the last 25 years. We assess public opinion and we see that we are quite friendly towards each other, but in case of any crisis, we support anti-neighbor policies. Daniel was saying that the wall wouldn't resolve anything, but the fact that we support the building of a wall which wouldn't resolve anything, it wouldn't hold migrants, it wouldn't protect you. And that really means how we are ready to follow the policy of fears. How can we be manipulated through irrational political actions? We are a conflict region, and the conflict between Russia and Ukraine will be resolved for several generations. Even if we freeze the war right now, but it doesn't look to be frozen, it moves on. So the situation turns for the worse, and our children and our grandchildren would be hating each other. The question of understanding the crisis in users. We are going to have an expert meeting in Brussels where the future of EU is going to be discussed. European bureaucrats invited philosophers, sociologists to discuss this unusual issue. And probably some of the ideas I have heard today I would relate over there. I heard your question in a different way. Well, I would like to respond it in a different way anyway, not the way the Europe understands the deepness of the crisis. What about the danger? I cannot speak on behalf of the European countries, but I may use the Russian experience. Presently, we see only too well the dangers in Russia. Russia shows that this difference between real threat and fear in the Ukraine and among right movements in Russia, so Russia works for disintegration. It tries to work with this wave. And even in Syria, Russia resolves not much of the Syrian problem, but it resolves its own problem, as distinct from countries operating in the solidarity logics. Other countries try to stick to disintegration trend, and which is dangerous. So probably sovereignty should be protected. I agree with that. And in Hungary, Russia, and there are specific reasons which are to be respected. But manipulation is so great. The difference between manipulation and real use for countries is so great that we see that mostly we try to deal with fears, or the work is based on fears. This is the manipulative policy, which is quite dangerous. Okay, the next range of questions.
Well, a few things. Well, first, I don't think that Mr. Orban was lost in translation. So he's made himself quite clear on a variety of occasions. And well, it is true that that this issue on illiberal democracy could be interpreted in many ways. But that's why I didn't use exactly this point. So I didn't speak so much about illiberalism and so on, but this idea of Europe with reduced solidarity, with more egoistic approaches on solving issues on countries on their own and so on. Well, it is true that what the colleague said, that Mr. Orban recently has supported a common European army, and that's apparently an exception to that trend. And I think that the more general point of interest here is that although in Eastern Europe, in many countries, we have speakers of this type as Mr. Orban, still there are quite large majorities of population who are for the European Union, and all leaders, they have to take this into account. Of course, these pro-European attitudes, they are in decline, and in some countries they're in question, for instance, the Czech Republic and so on. But in Poland and in Hungary, in my country, Bulgaria, there are still majorities of the people who are in support of the EU, and the paradoxical thing is that in some of these countries, people trust the EU more than local political elites. So this is a very specific situation in Central and Eastern Europe, which should be kept in mind when we discuss these questions.
Thank you. Пожалуйста, вы, потом Андреас Умланд.
Здравствуйте. Меня зовут Станислав, и я шизофреник. По крайней мере, у меня вот сегодня весь.
Well, today two personalities confront inside me. My first personality would like to thank Mikhail for demonization term, but the other speaks in support of post-modernization term, because universalism, my dear, is the idea of European advance, and by the end of the 20th century, modernism died in Europe, and the idea of post-modernism emerged. So basically it means that the idea of universalism is about to die too, because throughout the 20th century we saw the competition between various universalism ideas, that of Nazis, communists and others. And you made a point about the darkness coming from the East. Those barbaric tribes coming to destroy Rome. And totalitarian regimes can fall under this category too. So, following the destruction of the Roman Empire, some medieval times come again. That's the idea. So that is the idea of the world of my first personality, but the other comes back to the idea of the forum about the loss of universalism, and the loss is something that confuses me. And Daniel did well for showing us those pictures, and this personality that looks at that picture asks the question if there was any universalism at all before. So the question is, which personality is right? Because to understand where we're heading for, we should understand where we stand now, or where we stood before. Otherwise, it may seem that we lost the no return time. And speaking of lost universalism, and Mr. Fukuyama saw some kind of a mirage, but we believed in that, but we are still heading for universalism. So I would like to ask all the speakers, and perhaps that's a question to Yuri Sinakosov as well. Where do we stand now, and which is which picture is correct?
Yeah, my question goes to our Ukrainian Oswald Spengler, who has outlined us here the decline of the West. I'm saying that because we are friends and we know each other for a long time. I really liked your presentation a lot. I thought it was actually the best in a way, naturally the best here, because the topic of the conference is very philosophical, and as a trained philosopher, I think you captured it very well, this sort of philosophical contradictions. But I would challenge you and like you to be a little bit more philosophical, that what I was missing was a sort of the dialectics of this problem, of this issue. You had the thesis, the antithesis, but I was missing the synthesis. You know, I think the world spirit goes in zigzags. There is, in Europe we had this development of the European community where crises led then to new waves of integration. I'm not sure that it will be this way this time, you know, but that was the form of existence of the European. So with the Brexit, actually, it may, there might be a dialectics to it. It may actually demonstrate how important the European Union is. We have now Trump basically splitting the Republican Party. So there is, there is this counter reaction that's also coming, and it's not quite clear that it's going to be all that dark and all such a deep decline as you described it. So maybe you could sort of philosophize a little bit more on, where it could go. Or maybe there are other scenarios.
Я тогда начну с вопроса Андреаса и скажу свое мнение, отвечу Станиславу. Я сдерживал всеми силами.
I tried to stop short of exploring deeper philosophical matters. And perhaps partially it's because today is a very important day for me, and every time I come to Berlin, I always visit Gagel place. And during a lunch break, my colleagues and I went to the old cemetery and paid tribute to Gagel. And the dialectics for us is quite typical, and we are staying now in the city of not just the Gagel's tomb, but it's the city where the community was divided by the wall. That wall ran through the hearts, minds, and destinies of families, and with the fall of the wall, some research still show that the Germany is still is still divided, and it shows us that not all the crises could be resolved. I'm watching the developments in the EU as the set of institutions that benefit from crises, and World War II was the crisis of the crises, which led to the establishment of the European Union. And further on, every crisis led to the establishment of another institution that suggests that all prerequisites for this type of crisis are destroyed. Now we are at the crossroad, and there are two options. Either Europe would stand the pressure and become stronger, or we would be divulged into separatism and segregation, isolationism, and Europe may start other wars which would spread throughout the globe. And I believe that I should really work with the depth of the problem, and I should say some scaring things. Perhaps we do not hate each other, and we can launch nice projects or movements that would stop the decline. And actually, I'm provoking you, and I'm sorry for that. But that's part of the game. That's part of my work. And responding to the question, if there was a universalism, it is available here. In the 19th and 20th centuries, we made a lot of progress. Universal human rights were drafted, and philosopher Kant was mentioned here several times. And should I stop? And Kant wrote his main book during the crisis. You remember what was happening there. And perpetual peace theory was invented in the 18th century, because Kant thought that there would be no wars, and republics would be much stronger than monarchies, because they involve people in the political affairs much deeper, and the public would protect those countries from any invasion. And but Kant lived in the time when the three monarchies were dividing the republic, that was Austria, Prussia, and Russia. They were dividing Poland. And it so happened that republic was weaker than monarchy, and at the same time the French Republic under Napoleon, they invaded and annexed part of the Rhine province. So even it so happened that even the republic could be authoritarian, and we saw those examples a lot in the 19th century. So both theory and practice of engineering of new policies was seen. In the 20th century, UN and EU emerged. A lot of positive discoveries were made, and we live at the times when those discoveries are failing us, and that is a challenge for us. And it makes us to be further and deeper involved in creation, and not just to surrender.
Well, briefly to your question. So, I don't believe in this type of Hegelian philosophical epochs, that the modern epoch is over and postmodernism has arrived, and now everything is relative. There is no truth, and so on and so forth. So, but this methodological issue, I agree with you that you could say that. Look, since the situation is like that now, probably these values of solidarity were not so entrenched. They were not so well internalized by the people, anyhow. So now we notice it, but it has always been like that. So this is a fully legitimate point of view, and probably it's correct. So it doesn't change much the situation, it, apart from the conceptual thing in the title, so whether it was lost or was never established fully in the first place. But this doesn't change dramatically everything that has been discussed anyway, but thanks for the question.
Thank you very much for a very interesting discussion. I'm Pavel Utnyansky from Ukraine, from Kyiv. We are long friends with the school, and thank you for this wonderful event. I would like to speak of some new issues, some quotations, starting from early morning today, and I think Matthias started with a wonderful dream, saying that the European Union could do something else for the world, or United Europe. So there was a dream about the about peace in the Middle East and something else. So here at the last panel, when we were discussing, I think, the matter of European elites, and we spoke of some right-wing populist parties and left-wing populist parties, and the alternative for Germany was a right-wing populist project, but still they possess some political creation, and they are creative, and in the art of the political struggle they are ahead of the establishment. Another point of inflexibility was made of the ruling elites, and it's not only about politicians, it's also about business, big corporate interests. So there was some shortage of the political creation on their side. And old political or traditional political forces reproduce that European or EU red tape and bureaucracy, and it is in conflict with political life. People get bored with and disappointed with that. Migration was the first point, but the first disappointment came from another problem. It started from the humiliation of Greeks. It started from the conflict around Greece, and that was the first crisis of solidarity. We don't have to call them lazy people and inadequate people, but the Greek nation actually appealed to the world to be treated decently, and following that there was a referendum in Greece, and still United Europe didn't provide them with an adequate answer. Okay, so Greece swallowed that humiliation, but other opponents of European Union, they came to right conclusions. So those who are in favor of different policies, and because the choice is limited, they vote for those negative guys whose stand I cannot share. And because of that conflict, there was a social and economic conflict, we saw the rise of the migrants crisis, and we should really be in control of that. And if old elites fail to do so, and Spain is a very good example, if they fail to meet various coalitions halfway, if they are not prepared to surrender part of their power to them, then I'm pessimistic about the future. And the Ukrainians do not have a right to say critically about that, because the uprising or revolution which we saw in Kyiv several years ago was called Euromaidan. Euro is not an accidental prefix, because people came to the streets because they were angered with the refusal on the part of the Kyiv elite to join the European Union. So thank you very much, and I would like to apologize for speaking for so long. So you don't have a question. My question is, is there any hope, and how we can influence those bureaucracy elites, which are fully connected with some gray capital, and how can we can influence them, actually? I'd like to apologize, but can we allow people to come into the room? Okay, so please bring the microphone to them.
Hello, Stefano Bregaroli from the University of Tartu. I have a question, basically mostly has to do about values. We discussed a lot, integration from different perspectives, and one of the key points was exactly values. And we defined basically European integration and broadly European integration far beyond the borders of the EU as, in a way, a community of values. We started this morning quoting Havel, yeah, and we finished today quoting Orban. So we wonder how we had this kind of jump in 25 years. In a way, how we included among our community of values diversity, which then brought even to some dimensions such as illiberal democracy, how it found a room there. And again, I still believe that, you know, illiberal democracy, I keep using this brand because, in a way, I believe that could have been better translated. I mean, Mr. Orban speaks English, so I suppose that
Stefano,
he could have.
I like you so much, but yeah, we have a limit of the time.
Me too.
Could you please be very briefly?
And among these values, there is clearly a dimension of solidarity. Now, we have seen solidarity declined in very different ways. Selective solidarity, that was the last brand of the Visegrad Group. We had solidarity à la carte, sovereign solidarity. So my key question is, isn't this somehow reflecting a different vision, not only of solidarity and of values, but different understanding of sovereignty? Isn't simply that, you know, the EU enlarged has brought different dimensions of sovereignty. Old member states somehow joined by for sharing sovereignty, new member states joining for safeguarding sovereignty. And in that sense, my point is, are we sure that in order to defend universalism, don't we need to become less universal? Meaning that, you know, moving on with those who are willing to deepen integration and somehow to share more of these values and somehow, let's say, leaving space for the others to join
Thank
later.
You. Thank yeah. you. We will start with Daniel.
Actually, if it's about the discussion on values, I'm all for that. But when somebody comes and says, in order to meaningfully discuss specific values, we have to dismantle what we have without giving a specific alternative, which is more attractive, then I have a problem. And for instance, you could interpret partly the Brexit situation in this way. So it was also a discussion about sovereignty and so on and so forth. But until this very moment, we are not quite sure what actually Brexit means, apart from that Brexit means Brexit. So this is my worry, that on this argument, which is fully legitimate, that we need to discuss what solidarity means, what sovereignty means, and how to best approach these issues. Some people come and say, first let's dismantle and then see how it goes. and this to me is dangerous. And actually the loss of value in this approach is guaranteed. So this would be probably my short answer.
I think both solidarity and sovereignty have various meanings and can be interpreted in a variety of ways. And usually politicians and governments tend to interpret them whichever way suits them best. And we have an example of government saying, yes, we show solidarity with Europe in regards to the refugee crisis. But at the same time, sovereignty comes before solidarity. And as a result, we vote against the mandatory refugee quota. So it's up to every government and however they see fit and however that suits them for the moment.
It's a good question. At that time, said that everything is predictable in Russia and in Ukraine is not the case. And I can remember that we discussed both the Russian situation and that in the Western Europe. And there were some boring things about the European policy. Everything was predictable, no infusion of energy. But I think it was really the case in Western Europe and with their boring attitudes. But now we have some very passionate people who gathered here, and this group of
quite energetic people who are not quite well educated lead to that particularism. And I don't agree with Daniel that it's not universalism. I think it's the other side of universalism. And we should realize that our hope rests with the future that would revive the attractiveness of the project of Greater Europe.
On this issue about bureaucratic Europe. So, well, first, the whole membership of the European Commission officials is something like 30,000 people, and the Bulgarian Ministry of Interior has over 50,000 people. So we have to keep this into proportion when we speak about the Europe, European Union as a bureaucratic entity. And secondly, this issue of solidarity in the Greek crisis. So we can have the huge discussion on that, but to me, solidarity doesn't mean that somebody should give whatever the other party asks from them. So of course, probably there could have been better deal, I don't know, between Greece and Eurozone and so on, but solidarity also includes some form of balance. And we have to keep in mind that, for instance, the Greek debt was anyhow reduced by 50%, and there were quite other concessions. Probably it is going to be further reduced and so on and so forth. So it's not that black and white issue as you described it.
Thanks. Thanks. My name is Anna Maria Kish. I'm from the Central European University Budapest, so I'm a speaker for Hungary, and I just want to try to be brief. We will talk a lot about values, especially concerning Orban, but I would wondering whether you would sign up for what I think that it's not rather that it's not about values, rather about pragmatism, what Orban does, because he well enough remembers 2002 when he lost the elections to the Hungarian Socialist Party, and he had 8 years to do the homework, how to win elections and how to stay in power. So it's not that much about a liberal or whatever values he represents, but about winning hearts and minds of voters, what he does pretty well. So.
Köszönöm szépen for your question. Хорошо, я по-русски все-таки отвечу, если можно тогда с наушниками.
I could speak Hungarian, but it would take me long. I worked in your university, and I can tell you for sure that Mr. Orban and his political force, those are the two things that rest upon ideology. He shows a lot of pragmatism when he agrees to the establishment of the European army, and it shows. But Orban alone is not the problem. No. In Budapest, in Roman quarters, we understand that could be some armed volunteers headed by Mr. Jobbik, and I am familiar with the research of my colleagues from the Central European University, which shows a lot that those processes can be quite dangerous. And those even more radical parties, they add to the legitimacy of Mr. Orban. We know that a few days ago, several thousand of Hungarians in Budapest demonstrated in the rally against the Prime Minister. So there is still a choice, and Hungary has never been a lost case. But those constitutional amendments, they triggered a machinery of authoritarian rule. Same things are visible in Poland gradually, but constantly and continuously. Polish leaders amend the constitution in favor of a greater authoritarian rule. So, and Valent Moder wrote quite well about that. Okay, so thank you very much for that great number of questions. I have a strong request for you. Please ask your questions to the panelists on the sides of our forum. And in conclusion, I would like to say that there is a historian from the Stanford University who writes that migration and nationalism are those failed states. They are turning into the henchmen of apocalypse, capable of destroying the mankind. And speaking of the migration of values crisis, it is something that we realize, and if we do realize that, then there are opportunities to overcome that, to address the problem. It's something that leads us to the situation which we are not familiar with. But anyway, thank you very much for your participation. Thank you.